io anche lavoro, prima di lavorare nell'azienda, quel lavoro che era relato, io facevo l'ingegnere di sistemi di Bennett e adesso lavoro alla data sulla squadra del tempo reale. Purtroppo io non riesco a fare una presentazione tecnica in italiano ancora perché non parlo italiano bene, quindi la farò in portoghese. Sto scherzando. Neanche in portoghese riesco più, la farò in inglese perché ci sono dei termini che non lo so in italiano e anche in portoghese. So, what is stress? There are many tools to debug the Linux kernel, and there are tools to post-mortem analysis like crash, and you have a login, you have a print feed to print information. But when you need runtime information, information about tests running on the system, the best thing to use, the best set of tools to use, is the trace tools. A trace is like, hey, the function foo call the function bar, or hey, the function bar returned 2 microseconds after being called, and hey, the code processed this point, and the value of the variable x is 10. Another good thing about tracing is that it can be enabled and disabled for running time, so you can have it always there for you to use, and you can enable and disable when you want. And it means that it must to have a low overhead, meaning when it's disabled, and that's the case for Linux kernel. It generates a lot of data in dozen lines of trace per bit per second per CPU, so it must be very, very optimized. Well, what are the trace techniques that are currently available in the kernel? We have the static trace, that are points of trace that are compiled in the code, like a printf, but not a printf, something optimized. You can do the trace of the functions, all the functions that run inside the kernel. And you also have the dynamic trace that is a way to put points of the trace inside the kernel on runtime. On a point that you read the code and say, okay, I want to bring to the value the variable x in the scheduled call. Unfortunately, we will not have time to go into all these, and now you focus on the static trace and the trace of functions. That's the where it always and the tools that you basically need every time after doing analysis. So the trace techniques, we have the trace points for static trace, you have the f-trace for the trace of functions, and you can also do the dynamic trace using k-probes or earth-probes. And currently, you can use all these techniques via a trace interface that's in the way that Linux works. It's a directory with the files that you enable and disable things, and you set things, set parameters, and you collect the data back. So, the ftrace interface, or the trace interface, the ftrace is embedded on the kernel, so you do not need an external tool to use ftrace. Everything is there. It's accessible via debugfs, and the only tools that you need is echo to set parameters and get to get parameters for the data. So this is good for embedded systems. For example, I cannot use the system tab, another tool, on a release log or embedded system because it depends on the C library, that's the GNU library that is often not present on those systems. So that's good, you don't need the external tools to use FX. And it's generally mounted on /c/kernel debug trace, or you can mount it by hand. I put the Fedora, I know that Fedora had had it already mounted, and I know that the RHEL 6 you have to mount by hand. So, the trace interface is like a directory with a dozen of files. And, okay, this lecture in reality it's a how-to, it's a hands-on how-to that I deliver inside Red Hat for my peers. If you get the slides, you'll be able to do this presentation as a hands-on training. And that's the idea here. Show how easy it is to use this tool. So, starting by the function tracer. With function tracer, you can trace all the functions of the kernel that run inside the kernel. But only inside the kernel, not on user space. And only functions, because there are inline functions you cannot trace, and macros, obviously, they are. It's not a function you cannot trace as well. I do not have time to explain how it works here, but I left for you guys to read it after. And there is this presentation from Steven Rosen that he explains how it's enabled and how it's implemented. So the interface. Interface is files. So you have the available tracers that are options of trace of functions that you can enable and disable. You have this file that shows what is the current tracer enabled. Tab that shows the current tracer enabled, and that will use it to reset and change the tracers. The trace file is where you can read all the trace the system report. And you can also clean the trace buffer. And you can obviously enable and disable the trace. So, for example, on a round 7 box, I have these tracers. And the current tracer by default is the knob that's no tracer enabled. And it's not to add the overhead, so it does nothing. So, let's suppose that I wanted to trace all the functions of the kernel. I just echo the function tracer to the current tracer, and I enable it by setting 1 on the trace knob, and I can read the trace file, and it will show that the batch on CPU2 on this timestamp called the mutex lock that the function RB symbol write called mutex lock. And then it returned to the VFS write that called this function, and then called this function, and then called this function. You can see all the functions that run in the kernel. To disable the trace, just turn the trace off and set the knob tracer. Because when you set the tracer on the beginning of each function, it will call a function to record that it passed there. When you set to knob, it will just jump, it will be no operation, there will be no overhead, and there will be no tracer. And you can clean up the buffer. Well, the output of the function tracer, it's a little bit, let's say, it requires you to interpret it, to see which function called which function. But there is another trace that is the graph tracer. It also traces the call of the function, but it also traces the return of the function. So you can get the execution time of the function. It's a little bit more expensive and basic than the function tracer, but not that much. So here you can see like a C style file. 2 spaces, this function, started to run, then call run speed log, and then the 2 timer function were called, and it run and returned 0.47 microseconds. And so you can, this function returned on 1.9 microseconds. And it's way easier to interpret the trace output. So let's jump to another technique that are trace points. The trace points are points of the trace inside the kernel. Like if it was a printf, a passing here in the value of the kernel is increased. But as a tracer, you can enable and disable it at runtime. And it causes no overhead and all the benefits of the tracing techniques. So the trace points, it grab stored in the ftrace buffer. And these trace points are also known as trace events or paths. And they are organized on a subsystem, trace points name. The interfaces you have the available events. If you can't, it will show you all the events you can use. And you can enable and disable the events that you want to print. So, for example, if I read all the available events and I grab just the IR2 handler, I will see that I have these two trace points. That shows me when IR2 it starts to run and when it returns. So I have a lot of events. I'm just using this example, and I can just set the name of the event to this file, and it will enable this trace point. You can also append another trace point and have both trace points enabled. And you can also grab some name and enable all of them. Here I'm grabbing all the RHELs and some extended recap events. And this is how you disable all the events. So, for example, I want to get all RHEL handlers trace points information. I just grab this and turn to him. I set this image like I will show you previous slide. And it will print that, okay, the IRQ42 started to run, and this is the name of the handler, and it returned, and it was handled. And you can see all the IRQs that occurred in the system that took place. So you can see all the functions that run, and the events, and then the functions that continue to run. But that's too much information. So it's not practical to read all the trace of all functions and try to find something there, because it's generated like a megabytes and gigabytes of data in just seconds. So, and you're not always evaluating all the system functions, but just a fewer set of functions or events, or just some fewer cases. But, so to resolve this problem, it's possible to filter which functions you want to trace, and also it's possible to filter which trace points you want to trace and on which conditions, like by the content of the trace point. Let's try to start by the ftrace. The interfaces, the available filter functions, are the functions that you can trace and filter. The set ftrace filter is the file where you write the function, the name of the functions that you can see in the trace, that you want to see. And you can also use the no trace to say, okay, I do not want to see these functions. And you can also filter by the P of the process. For example, I want to see just the functions called by this process. So here, just an example, use an example. All the functions that you can trace, there's a lot of functions, to record when the mutex logs were called and the mutex log were called. I can just write this for set ftrace filter. I can read which functions are enabled for me to filter. And this is how I reset the set ftrace filter. I reset the filter and so I can have all the functions back. So, user example. I want to trace the calls from mutex lock and mutex unlock. I want to see the functions, when these functions are called. For just for one process, I enable the trace and these mutex. And you can also use this filter for the function graph tracing, that one that records the start and return of the function. So you can have the execution time for the mutex lock, for example, and the mutex unlock. And you can also use build cards to enable the filter. For example, I want to trace all mutex, all functions that start with mutex. And then it will enable all functions that start with mutex. Or when I'm developing a network driver module, I can say that I want to see all the functions of that module. In this case of the DM environment. So, filtering trace points. You do not need to filter the trace points because you already selected the trace points. So, you don't enable all trace points. But, in this case, you can filter on which conditions you want to print the trace points. So, trace points are not just a printf in the code. They are structured information, and you can use this structured information to select what you want to see. So, the basic trace point and filter interface. The trace points are organized and classified on the subsystem and the event name. So, for each trace point, inside the events directory, you have the subsystem name and the event name. For example, for that RQ handler, events are RQ handler entry. And inside each directory, you have the interface for the trace points. You can enable the trace point, you can set filter options, you can read the format of the data, the structure that it saves, and the ID of the trace point. So, for example, I have this, I enable this, the trace points, the regular visit and entry. And here I can see. And here you can see that it's showing two interrupts, but I don't want to see all the interrupts, just a single interrupt. So I enter in the directory, the interface is here, the format of the file, you can see, okay, it will show the type of the trace, the common flags, the parent count, these are the prefix of the trace. And you can also see here the RQ, that's an integer, and the name of the hammer. So this is the print format, the RQ, the name of the hammer. And you can filter, for example, saying, okay, I want to print only if the RQ is equal to 14. And I can do the same for the AC, only RQ 14. And that's it. I prefer to do it started and return. And you can do even more complex filtering. For example, I have this trace point that is this scan wake up that brings information of when a test is awakened. This test was awakened, and this is the name of the test, and this is the beat of the test. And it shows, okay, the command line, the bid, the priority, if it succeeds, and the target CPU. So, for example, if I want to print only the process, the wake up of a process that have the priority minor than 100, that is the real time process in Linux, I just set this filter minor than 100. Moreover, I want to see when this first point shows the test switch between one thread or one test and another test by the scheduler. So when I have the context switch, I print a lot of information. But in this case, I want to filter the information. The previous state is equal to go into speed, and the previous priority is a real-time priority. Or the next priority is a test that is leaving the processor. It's a real-time test that's going to sleep. And I want to see when the test started to use the processor, it is a real-time test. And enable it. And so I can go back to the base directory and see the trace. And I will be able to see anytime a real-time test is awaited, when it starts to run and when it finishes to run. So I can have the delay between the test being awakened and it going to sleep after this activation. That's useful for real-time analysis. For example, I see that my test was awakened and fewer microseconds after it started to run and was fewer microseconds after it finished its execution. And you can do many kind of analysis using trace. You can read, there are a lot of options, but I don't have time. You can read per CPU information on this directory, so you can see all the functions and all the trace points that have run on that CPU. You can read, when you read the trace file, it will like show everything that run until you call the cache, read it and finish. But you can use the trace file like if it was a table-f, and it will continue showing the events taking place. That's also available for our CPUs. And there are way more things, like you can trigger actions when something happens. For example, you can enable, I want to enable the trace after this function were called. And then when this test started to run, I want to disable the trace. Or I want to get the stack trace that called the function. For example, the schedule, I want to see the stack trace of the test from where it entered in the kernel until it called the schedule. You can have a snapshot of the trace, like if this event take place, save a snapshot of the trace, but continue tracing. The trace command is a command line interface for the ftrace interface. You can do everything on a command line, and it will save you in a file that you can read on another box. And you also have a graphical interface that's